Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Prelims Warm Up. So in this initiative, we are looking at five questions which have been asked in the previous year UPSC questions. Now this initiative has been brought to you by Aptiplus Academy for Civil Services, and my name is Shayak Datta. I'm the Faculty for Geography and Environment at Aptiplus Academy for Civil Services. So today we are going to look at five such questions which have been asked in the previous year UPSC Prelims examination. Let us start with the first question. The first question was asked in UPSC Prelims 2019. This question is asking, okay, why is there a great concern about the microbeads that are released into the environment? Why is there a great concern about the microbeads which are released into the environment? A. They are considered harmful to the marine ecosystems. B. They are considered to cause skin cancer in children. C. They are small enough to be absorbed by crop plants in irrigated fields. And D. They are often found to be used as food adulterants. Okay, so the question is with regards to microbeads, and the question is from environment. So let us have a look at the explanation part. First of all, what is meant by microbeads? So what are microbeads? They are manufactured solid plastic particles of less than 1 millimeter in their largest dimension. They are most frequently made of polyethylene, but can be of other petrochemical plastics such as polypropylene, polystyrene, etc. Microbeads are small pellets of plastic which are extensively used in personal care products, for example shampoo, for example baby lotions, face cream, and they are considered to be toxic to marine life, and hence they are being banned on an international scale. So they are being banned international basis. So out of the given options, as you can understand, okay, option A, microbeads, they are considered to be harmful to the marine ecosystem, and that is why they are being banned internationally. That is the right answer. Moving on to question number two. Question number two is from history, and the question is asking, and this was also asked in UPSC Prelims 2019. Question is asking, a building Kalyana Mandapas was a notable feature in the temple construction in the kingdom of which dynasty? Okay, so in which kingdom basically Kalyana Mandapa was a notable feature in the temple construction? A. Chalukya. B. Chandela. C. Rashtrakuta. And D. Vijayanagara Empire. So out of these, where do we get to see this concept of Kalyana Mandapa, which was a notable feature in the temple construction? So let us go through the explanation part and let us see. Answer should be D. Vijayanagara. So a Kalyana Mandapa, it was meant to celebrate divine weddings in Vijayanagara Empire. And even today also, if you go to Karnataka, you will get to see Kalyana Mandapas are present. So Kalyana Mandapa, it was a notable feature in the case of the temples of the Vijayanagara Empire, and it was meant to celebrate divine weddings. So that is why the right answer is D. So 2D should be the right answer. That is Vijayanagara Empire. Now moving on to the third question for today. The third question, it was also asked in UPSC Prelims 2019, and there are three statements which have been given. You have to find out the correct statements. Number one, in the revenue system, in the revenue administration of the Delhi Sultanate, the in charge of revenue collection was known as Amil. Okay. In the revenue administration of the Delhi Sultanate, the in charge of revenue collection was known as Amil. Number two, the Ikta system of the Sultans of Delhi was an ancient indigenous institution. Ikta system of the Sultans of Delhi, it was an ancient indigenous institution. Three, the office of Mir Bakshi came into existence during the reign of Khalij Sultans of Delhi. The office of Mir Bakshi, it came into existence during the reign of Khalij Sultans of Delhi. And you have been asked out of the given statements, which of them are correct. Okay, so this is from history, as you can understand. Let us look at the explanation part. So in the revenue administration of the Delhi Sultanate, we get to see that the in charge of revenue collection was known as Amil. Remember, in case of the revenue administration of the Delhi Sultanate, the person who was in charge of revenue collection, he or she was called as Amil. Next is the initial Turkish. So first statement, as you can understand, it is correct. This was the first statement. What was the second statement saying? The Ikta system of Sultans of Delhi was an ancient indigenous institution. So let us have a look. The initial Turkish conquest in India in the early 13th century displaced many local chiefs. So in order to consolidate, the Turkish rulers made revenue assignments to Kajata's Ikta. I'll repeat. The initial Turkish conquest in India in the early 13th century, they displaced many local chiefs. And in order to consolidate all these small areas in order to consolidate, the Turkish rulers made revenue assignments, or which are called as iktas, in lieu of cash to their nobles. So iktas were provinces or spheres of influence which were put under the charge of officers, and these kind of officers, they were called as iktadars, or in other words, they were governors of these provinces. Okay, so what were iktas? Iktas were provinces or spheres of influence which were put under the charge of officers, and such officers, they were called as iktadars. Now, what is ikta? Ikta is an Arabic word, and the institution has been in force in the early Islamic world as a form of reward for services to the state. It was used in the caliphate administration as a way of financing operations and paying civil and military officers. It was not an ancient indigenous institution. So this concept that the ikta system of the sultans of Delhi was an ancient indigenous institution, that is incorrect, because it had come from Turkey. It was not indigenously made. Okay, so ikta is an Arabic word, and the institution, it had been quoted the early Islamic world as a form of reward for services to the state. It was used in the caliphate administration as a way of financing the operations and paying civil and military officers. It was not an ancient indigenous institution. So the second statement, as you can understand, is incorrect. Moving on to the third statement. The third statement, if we see, it was saying that the office of Mir Bakshi, the office of Mir Bakshi came into existence during the reign of the Khalif Sultans of Delhi. The office of Mir Bakshi had come into existence during the reign of Khalij or Khalji Sultans of Delhi. So let us see, in Akbar's administration, the military department was headed by Mir Bakshi. Okay. So in case of Akbar's administration, we get to see that the military department was headed by Mir Bakshi, who looked after all the matters which are pertaining to the military administration. He was also considered as the head of the nobility. So Mir Bakshi was heading the military department, as also we get to see that the Mir Bakshi was also considered to be the head of nobility. So the third statement, which says that the office of Mir Bakshi came into existence during the reign of the Khalji Sultans of Delhi, that is incorrect. So the only correct statement that we get to see is number one, and hence the right answer should be A, one only. Moving on to the fourth question. Fourth question is also from history, and we get to see that there are two statements which have been given, and you've been asked to find out of these two statements, which out of them are correct. First statement is, and this was also asked in UPSC Prelims 2019. First statement is Saint Nimbarka was a contemporary of Akbar. And second statement is saying Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi. Okay, Saint Nimbarka was a contemporary of Akbar. Second statement is saying that Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi. And you have to find out which out of these are correct. So let us have a look. So who is Nimbarka? He was a Telugu Brahmin. He is believed to have been a younger contemporary of Ramanuja. He spent most of his time in Vrindavan near Mathura in North India. He believed in total devotion to Krishna and Rama. The Mughal Emperor Akbar, he lived from 1542 to 1605. So as you can understand, the period does not match. So you cannot call Nimbarka to be a contemporary of Akbar. So Nimbarka, he was a contemporary of Ramanuja, but not of Akbar. So who was Nimbarka? He was a Telugu Brahmin. He believed to have, he was a younger contemporary of Ramanuja, and he lived in the 11th century. He spent most of his time in Vrindavan near Mathura in case of North India, and he believed in total devotion to Krishna and Rama. The Mughal Emperor Akbar, on the other hand, he lived around 1542 to 1605. Hence the first statement, which was saying that Saint Nimbarka was a contemporary of Akbar, that is incorrect. The second statement, Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi. So over here we get to see that Naqshbandi Sufi Singh, that is Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi, he was in Haryana in the period of 1642. Whereas Kabir Das, he is a 15th century mystical poet, a great Bhakti saint of India. He is the most important Nirguna Bhakti saint. We are talking about Kabir Das. He is the most important Nirguna Bhakti saint. The Nirguna Bhakts were devotees of a formless, that is what is meant by Nirguna. The Nirguna Bhakts, they were devotees of a formless god. Even while calling him variously as Rama, Govinda, Hari, or Raghunath. But they believe in a formless God. So the second statement in the question was saying that Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi. That is also incorrect, because as you can see that Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi was in Haryana in the period of 1624, whereas Kabir Das was a 15th century mystical poet and a great soul. There is no connection between the two. So the second statement is also incorrect, and we get to see that the right answer is D, neither one nor two. Okay, so with this we finally move to the last question for the day. And the last question is saying that there are three statements which have been given, and this is from modern India, this question, and this was also asked in UPSC prelims 2019. The question is asking, with reference to the British colonial rule in India, consider the following statements. Okay, with reference to the British colonial rule in India, consider the following statements. First statement is that Mahatma Gandhi was instrumental in the abolition of the system of indentured labor. So basically forced labor or indentured labor. Mahatma Gandhi was instrumental in the abolition of the system of indentured labor. That is the first statement. The second statement is saying in Lord Chelmsford War Conference, Mahatma Gandhi did not support the resolution on recruiting Indians for World War. Third statement is saying, consequent upon the breaking of salt law by the Indian people, the Indian National Congress was declared illegal by the colonial rulers. Okay, so these three statements have been provided, and you have to find out which out of this are correct. So let us go to the explanation part. First is that Mahatma Gandhi was instrumental in the abolition of the system of indentured labor, especially in case of South Africa. As we know, if you look at the history of Mahatma Gandhi before he came to India, he was working in South Africa mainly. For the cause of indentured labor over there. So Mahatma Gandhi was instrumental in the abolition of the system of indentured labor in South Africa. So the first statement is correct. Let us look at the second statement. In Lord Chelmsford War Conference, Mahatma Gandhi did not support the resolution on recruiting Indians for World War. Now, what about this? If you look at this particular statement, we get to see that moderates had supported the First World War, but Gandhi did not. So basically, the statement 2 is not correct, saying that. So here we get to see Lord Chelmsford War Conference. Mahatma Gandhi did not support the resolution on recruiting Indians for World War. Okay. So Gandhi, as you can understand, in this case, Gandhi had supported the recruitment of Indians for the First World War by the British, basically. So the second statement is absolutely incorrect. The third statement that we have, that is, consequent upon the breaking of salt law by Indian people, the Indian National Congress was declared illegal by the colonial rulers. So in this case, we get to see that Congress was declared illegal by British government after the launch of the second phase of the civil disobedience movement. It was not a factor that favored in launching of second phase of civil disobedience movement. Let us quickly go through it. The second statement was saying that consequent upon the breaking of the salt law, when did that happen? During the civil disobedience movement. So consequent upon the breaking of the salt law by the Indian people, the Indian National Congress was declared illegal by the colonial rulers. But if I look at the explanation part, in the explanation part, we can get to see that Congress was declared illegal by the British government after the launch of the second phase of the civil disobedience movement. It was not a factor that favored in launching of second phase of civil disobedience movement. So the third statement that has been provided, that is also correct. That is, after the breaking of the salt law by the Indian people during the civil disobedience movement, the Indian National Congress was declared illegal by the colonial rulers. So statement one and three are correct. Statement two, it is not correct. So the right answer is 5B. 5B is the correct answer. Okay. So with this, we have seen all five questions for today's episode of Prelims Soma. We'll be back again with another episode. Please let us know if you have liked this video. Please like, comment, and share this video with other UPSC aspirants. Also, please subscribe to Aptiplus Academy for Civil Services YouTube channel for more such informative videos. So till the next time, please take care and study hard. Thank you so much.